we derived already the mass and stiffness matrices of a beam when we consider only axial displacements. So only the left and the right ends deflect in the direction of the beam, the straight beam. Now we're going to consider bending. So we're going to derive the elements of the stiffness matrix that correspond to the degrees of freedom for translation, lateral motion, and also rotation of the left end and the right end. So we're going to construct now a 4x4 matrix for the stiffness that corresponds to these 4 degrees of freedom, and also another for these degrees of freedom. So stiffness and mass matrices. Okay, so we approximate now, the objective is to approximate this beam that has lateral displacements and rotations in terms of a 4 degree of freedom system. And the 4 degrees of freedom are the 2 lateral displacements of the 2 ends and the rotations of the 2 ends. So we'll end up with a 4x4 stiffness matrix and also a 4x4 mass matrix. Okay? And the way that we are going to do the approximation is by approximating the kinetic energy of this beam with the kinetic energy of a discrete system, and do the same thing for the potential energy in order to get a stiffness matrix. Okay, again, the assumption is that the displacement all over along the beam, the lateral displacement, is expressed in terms of the product of a shape function times the displacement at one end or the other. Okay, what is the significance of a shape function? For example, what is the significance of psi 1 of x? Okay, let's make a mental experiment. Suppose that you displace the left end by 1 unit, okay, but you don't let the end to rotate, the left end to rotate. You just displace it, but you force it to remain horizontal. And on the right end, you constrain that it both the displacement and the rotation. So you will see a displacement pattern that looks something like this. Unit displacement, no rotation, so at this end the beam is horizontal, and then the displacement decreases to 0 at the right end, and at the right end also you have no rotation. Okay, so in plain English, psi 1 of x, which is the mod shape, the first mod shape, is the vertical displacement along the beam, vertical displacement along the beam, if the left end is reason by 1 unit. So we rise the left end by 1 unit, and we force all the other rotations and displacements to be 0. So end remaining displacements and slopes to be again, we're trying to imagine that we lift the left hand by one unit, we force it so that it doesn't rotate, and we constrain completely the right hand so that there's no displacement, no rotation. So the shape that the beam will assume is the first Mach shape. Okay? So this is psi 1 of x. This is x over L. And this is 1. Okay. So again, the constraints are that psi 1 at 0, which corresponds to the displacement of the left hand in the vertical direction, is 1. Everything else is 0. So no slope, psi 1 at 0 is equal to 0. Psi 1 at the right hand is 0, and so does, or so is, the slope at the right hand. Okay, here is the equation for psi 1 of x. Psi 1 of x is 1 minus 3 x over L squared plus 2 times x over L into the cubic power. Okay? This is the displacement of the beam if you raise the the left hand by one unit and you don't let it rotate and also constrain the other end. That would be the expression. How do we come up with this expression? Well, you remember the equation for the displacement of the beam. This is an equation that involves fourth order derivatives. So if you try to solve this differential equation and you impose the boundary conditions, these boundary conditions, you will come up with this equation. It's a fourth degree equation, so when you solve it, you get a cubic polynomial. If you want to check if this is right, if this is equation of is right, put x equal to 0 here to see if the displacement is 0. Is it? Well, you have 1 minus 3, this becomes 1. The displacement at the left end had to be 1. So if you put x equal to 0, this is 1 minus 0 plus 0 equal to 1, as expected. What about the right end? How do we check that the displacement at the right end is 0? When we put x equal to L, so we put here x equal to L, then you have 1 minus 3 plus 2, which makes 0, so indeed it's 0. And you can do the same checks for the slopes to verify that all the conditions are satisfied. Okay, so that's the mode shape, the first mode shape, and we have 3 more. Okay, we have a total of 4 mode shapes. In the second mode shape, you rotate the left hand by one unit, and you constrain everything else. You constrain the displacement to be 0, you just rotate the beam. So this is psi 2 of x. If you rotate the left hand, this is x, you get something like this, a shape like this. All right, and the expression is psi 2 of x equal to x minus 2 times the length x squared, let's put x over L squared plus L x over L cube. That's the second mod set. If you rotate this end. Okay, how about psi 3? In the third mod set, we constrain the left end, no rotation, no displacement. And the right end is rotated by one unit, okay? The positive is counterclockwise, so we for psi 3, we lift the right end and we keep it horizontal. So we assume a shape like this. This is psi 3. This is actually what you obtain if you flip this mod shape. Okay, if you rotate it, then you get the third mod shape. So this is psi 3 of this. And the equation is pretty easy to calculate. If you know the first mod shape, it is psi 3 of x equal to 1 minus 3 L minus x over L squared plus 2 times L minus x over L into the cubic power. Okay, the last one is obtained if you rotate the right end by one unit, everything else is zero. Zero displacement, zero slope at the left end, zero displacement at the right end, but unit rotation at the right end. Remember also rotation is positive in the counterclockwise direction. Okay. Positive direction is counterclockwise. Okay. So let's get the mass matrix. For the mass matrix, we are going to write the equation for the kinetic energy. So this is the integral 1/2 over the length density times area times the velocity squared dx. Okay, that's the kinetic energy. And then you can, if this is the kinetic energy of the continuous beam, you try to make it equal to this sum, 1 to 4, j equal to 1 to 4 of mij. These are the elements of the mass matrix. There are 16 elements. 4 times 4 is 16 times vi dot times vj dot. And this is written as 1/2 v dot task force times the mass matrix times B dot. Okay, and I'll write an equation for the elements of this mass matrix. These are the elements of the mass matrix. And this mass matrix has to be will be determined so that the kinetic energy using this mass matrix and the displacements, the kinetic energy using this matrix equals to the kinetic energy of the beam. Okay? So a 4-degree of freedom system, a 4-degree of freedom system with mass matrix M has same kinetic energy with a beam. Okay. So this is the concept of finding the mass matrix of the beam. It will be a 4x4 matrix and we'll write that expression. Okay? So that is about the mass matrix. Now let's consider the stiffness matrix. How do we get the stiffness matrix? Well, we have to find the elements so that the potential energy of the discrete system with the 4 degrees of freedom is equal to the potential energy of the beam. Okay? That's how we find the stiffness matrix. So, similarly for the stiffness matrix, the potential energy in bending is 1/2 the integral from 0 to L, EI, and here we have curvature with respect to the length, squared dx, okay? So V is equal to 1/2, and we have a sum with 16 terms. So I from 1 to 4, J also from 1 to 4, K, I, J, V, I, V, J, equal to 1/2 the displacements, which are this is the transpose of a column vector with 4 elements, the 4 displacements, times the stiffness matrix K, a 4x4 matrix, times the displacements. So we write here where K ij is the integral over the length of ei m, second derivative of psi I dx squared times second derivative psi I psi j, I'm sorry, x squared dx. Okay, and this will give you the 16 elements of the stiffness matrix. So it's important to write here that a discrete system with more degrees of freedom with this stiffness and this mass matrix has the same kinetic and potential energy like this continuous beam. Okay? A discrete four degree of freedom system with stiffness matrix chain. The same potential energy as the beam. In terms of the forces, you need also, when you discretize a system, and you have just 4 degrees of freedom, to put the forces only on the 4 degrees of freedom. So you may have a distributed force over the length of the beam, but you have to distribute it over the, to concentrate it on the 4 degrees of freedom, the two ends, okay? So the forces, you can find them using this equation that involves an integral of the force times the displacement dx, and this would be equal to the work of the forces. So the forces that are concentrated, the four concentrated forces, will be obtained from integration of the force times the corresponding mod shape over the length. Okay. So if you find the mass, the stiffness matrices, and also the concentrated forces, then the equation of motion of a discrete system that approximates the continuous is this. It is the mass matrix times the vector of the four accelerations, two displacements and two rotations, plus the stiffness matrix times the vector of the displacements, the four displacements, equal to the force. Okay. Now I will demonstrate how to calculate just one element of the mass matrix, and then I will write the entire mass matrix. So mass matrix. M11 is the integral over the length of rho A times the mod shape that corresponds to displacement. So it is the vertical displacement. So you have 1 minus 3 x over L squared plus 2 x over L cube squared dx. And this is equal to, if you do the integration, it will be 156 over 420 times the mass of the beam. So density times area times length gives the mass of the beam. This is the mass of the beam. So we have 156 over 420, the mass of the beam, which is approximately something like 1/3 of the length of the mass of the beam. Okay, the mass matrix, let's write the expression for the mass matrix, and now we're considering lateral displacements. First we put the mass, rho AL divided by 420, and then we'll write the elements, and now we'll write only the upper elements. So we have 16 elements, but because the matrix is symmetric, we can get by writing only the elements that are above the diagonal, this diagonal, and on the diagonal. So we have 156, 22 times the length, 54, and minus 13 times the length, okay? All right, so this is the first row. The second row, we have 4 L squared, 13 L minus 3 L squared. That's the second row. And of course, of symmetry, you can tell that this element is 22 times L. Okay, this is 22 times L. Then for the third row, we just give 156. Okay, minus 22 times the length. And the last element is 4L squared. Okay, so this is the 16, the 4x4 mass matrix. Okay, so if someone didn't work with finite elements and kinetic energies, and would put on the left end something like half of the mass of the beam, okay? But if you want to be accurate so that you match kinetic energies, then you have to put to the end of the beam only about 1/3, okay? Actually, 156 over 420 times AL is approximately 37% of the mass of the beam, of beam mass. 37%, which is pretty close to 1/3. And you wouldn't know that unless you do all these calculations with potential and kinetic energies. How about the stiffness matrix? I'll just get the final result, and you know by now the method that this was derived. So for the stiffness matrix, K, it is E I over L Q.
cube. And then you have these elements here, a 4x4L matrix with elements. We have 12, 6L, minus 12, 6L, 4L squared. Minus 6L, 2L squared, 12, minus 6L, and 4L squared. Okay, and the matrix is symmetric. Okay. Just to develop some intuition about what is the meaning of the terms in the mass and the stiffness matrix, okay? Suppose that we accelerate the left node by upwards by one unit, okay? So let's make a mental experiment. Accelerate the left end, the left node upwards . Okay, so the acceleration vector is just one for the first degree of freedom, the displacement of the left end, and zero elsewhere. Okay? So this is what we are doing. This is the beam, the original position, and now we accelerate it. There's no displacement, we just accelerate the left end without rotating it. So this is V1. Okay? Well, the elements of the mass matrix give you the forces that you need to exert in order to produce this result. In other words, in order to have a unit acceleration in this end, no rotations, okay? This is the meaning of the elements of the matrix. So the required forces are the required forces to produce this result. Divided by 420, and then you have these elements, okay, the four elements, which are 156, 22 times the length, 54, and minus 13 L. Okay, and if you want to visualize the beam with all the forces and moments, then on the left-hand side, you apply a force equal to about one-third of the mass. So the force that you apply in order to accelerate the left end by one unit is 0.37 times the mass, okay? You also exert a moment, okay, which is counterclockwise, that means positive, 5% times m L. On the right hand side, you have a force which is 0.313 m, so it is 13% of the mass, and then you have a moment, clockwise moment, clockwise means negative, it is minus 3% m l. Okay. So this is about the mass matrix. Now, if you want to gain some intuition about the stiffness matrix, which is this one, let's make another mental experiment where we want to displace the left end, the left node, upward by one unit. And we want to keep everything else to be zero, no rotation, just move it upwards without rotation. So the forces that are required are in the first column of the stiffness matrix. Okay? So, displace the left node upward so you have this displacement vector. Okay? What force is required? The force that is required is obtained by multiplying the stiffness matrix times this vector. Okay? So to find the force, you multiply the stiffness matrix K that we just derived on that right side of the board times this vector 1, 0, 0, 0. Okay? This means that you will get from this multiplication, the elements in the first column of the stiffness matrix. Okay? So you will get these elements, okay? EI L cube over times 12 for the first, the second element will be 6L times this, and so on. So what you need, the required forces are EI over L cubed, and then you have this vector 12, 6L, minus 12, 6L. Okay? So these are the forces in order to displace the upper node by one unit, while there's no rotation of the left node, and also nothing happens to the right node. So with this we get hopefully an understanding of the stiffness matrix. Now, before we continue with torsion, we have to consider, besides, we have considered axial displacements. So if you have a beam, you have axial displacements. You have also lateral displacements, so we have addressed that. We have to consider also twist. That's also something that we have to consider. But before that, let's make an example, again, to practice and gain some intuition. We have a cantilever beam, the properties are E, A, the length is capital L, moment of inertia is I, and rho is the density. Okay, so we have a force. The force is unit on the right hand side, and as a result of this vertical force, you lift this end. Okay, so if you lift the end, there'll be a displacement delta that you want to find. So find delta. Okay, so based on what we learned, how do you find the displacement of the right end of the beam in this situation? Okay. Well, we can write the force vector. Okay. If we write the force vector, then we'll use the equation stiffness matrix times displacement equal to the force vector, and we'll find the displacement. Okay? So the force vector, there are four forces. Well, on the left hand side, you have reactions. You have a reaction R1. This is R1, vertical. You have a reaction R2. Okay? And then on the right hand side, you have a force 1 and no rotation, no torque on the right-hand side. So if you want to have the force vector will have four elements, right? What would be the elements? R1, R2, which we don't know, so we just write them. Then you have a force equal to 1, on the third degree of freedom, which is this, and no torque on the right hand side, so the last element is 0. So this is the force vector. Okay. No accelerations, okay, 0 accelerations. This is static. Okay, so we consider the equation. What is the equation that we consider? Well, the mass matrix times accelerations plus stiffness matrix times displacements. These are vectors, 4 by 4 vectors, equal to the force vector, right? And because the problem is static, no accelerations, this term is 0, okay? All right, so we have K times X equal to the force. All right, so let's write the equations. K is a 4 by 4 matrix, so we write K11, K12, K13, K14, K41. I will not write everything. This is K44. Okay. Then we have the displacements, okay? Well, the displacement at the left end are zero. So these terms here are zero, right? And we have, how about the other displacements? We have U3, this is the vertical displacement, this, and we have also rotation, U4, okay? And on the right hand side, we have the forces. And the forces are actually R1, R2, 1, and 0. Okay? One is the vertical force, and there's no torque, so this is 0. Let's work with the last two equations. Okay? So we have the last two equations. Okay? So if we have the last two equations, notice that these terms are zero, so the first, whatever is multiplied with zero, such as K43, for example, you'll multiply K43 times zero, so it will go away. So everything, the first two columns, will go away because of the zeros. So you will have K33, everything in the third column, times U3, which we don't know, plus K34 times U4, equal to 1, right? That's 1. That's the third equation. Third equation. From the fourth equation, you have K43 times U3 plus K44 times U4 equal to zero, because there is no moment. Okay? So going back to the stiffness matrix of the of a beam, we put the elements and we get 3 EI for the last two equations over L cube 12 minus 6L minus 6L 4L squared times U3, displacement of the right end and rotation of the right end. So U4 equal to 1, we have a unit force on the right hand side and no torque, so we put 0. But we can solve these equations. Okay? So if you solve these equations, you get that U3, we solve for U3, which is delta, that displacement on the right end, this is equal to L cube over 3EI. Okay, so this is how much the right end is going to be displaced if you apply a unit force. Okay? If you use Euler-Bernoulli theory or a Castigliano, you'll get the same displacement. Okay? So this is the same result as beam theory, the one from beam theory. Euler Bernoulli beam theory. Okay. Let's consider also torsion. coordinate system X is along the length Y and Z. So now we have rotation of theta function of X and T. Okay. The potential energy is 1/2 Gj d theta dx square dx. And I'm using partial derivative because theta is a function of both x and t. We are taking derivative with respect to x. Okay? T is this expression. Now, we have to approximate again the rotation as a function of mode shapes times the rotations of the two ends, the left end and the right end. Okay? So we make this approximation. Psi 1 of x times the rotation of the left end plus psi 2 of x times the rotation of the right end. So everything is expressed in terms of the two rotations. Psi 1 of x is a linear function, 1 minus x over L. Psi 2 of x is x over L. Similar shapes as the shapes for axial. But if you do the similar derivations, then you get the stiffness matrix, which is Gj over L. And then you have these elements, 1, minus 1, minus 1, 1. And then the mass matrix is rho times moment of inertia in the torsion times L divided by 6. And then you have here the elements 2, 1, 1, 2. That's the matrix that corresponds to the masses. Okay. So now we have covered axial displacements, lateral, and also rotations. So how many degrees of freedom, if we put everything together, we're going to get a stiffness matrix. How many degrees of freedom do we have for the whole stiffness matrix? Well, if you think about the left end of the beam, this is the beam, okay? How many degrees of freedom do you have? You have three displacements. Okay? And three rotations, right? You have rotations. You have rotations about all the degrees of freedom. Okay, so 6 for the left hand, 6 for the right hand. So the matrix that we'll end up with is a 12 by 12 matrix. So you'll have a 12 by 12 stiffness matrix and another 12 by 12 mass matrix. Okay? So let's look at these matrices. Okay, so let's bring the contour. Let's see first the degrees of freedom. We see we have three displacements. Axial, two lateral, and then we have rotations. So we have torsion and two bending, two displacements under bending, horizontal and vertical. Okay, this is the stiffness matrix. Okay, it's a 12 by 12 matrix. It is symmetric. And this corresponds to the axial displacement. Okay? So if you want to, what is the meaning of this element, EAL? Well, if you want to displace the beam by one unit in the axial direction, and all other, everything else is zero, all other displacements, rotations are zero, then the force that you need to exert is EAL. So you need to apply a force equal to EAL in order to stretch the beam by one unit. Okay, that's the meaning of this. Let's look at this term. This term corresponds to bending. This is bending in the vertical direction. So if you want to deflect in the vertical direction the beam, then let's see, this is U2, okay, so in the vertical direction, this is the moment that, I'm sorry, this is the force that you need to apply in the vertical direction to have displacement in that direction. The other elements, you have different elements, and they are necessary in order to maintain no rotation. So, I'm sorry, no displacement. So if you don't want to have a displacement, you have to also keep the beam from rotating, and that's why you need to apply also a moment to that. Okay? So the elements that you see that correspond to moments are because you need to maintain no rotation. This term here is because you want to maintain equilibrium. So you apply a moment on one end, okay, or force on one end, then you need to apply an equal and opposite force on the other end to maintain equilibrium. That's why you have this force here, which is equal and opposite to this force. And these two moments are in order to keep the two ends from rotating. Okay, so this is the meaning of the terms, and you can think the same way for the rest of the terms in the mass matrix. There is also a stiffness matrix that is given here. That's a stiffness matrix. And again, I'm sorry, that's the mass matrix. So you see that this term is about 33%, one third of the mass of the beam. Okay. And this is telling you what force you need to apply the right end to give it a unit acceleration. Okay. All right, so today we completed the derivation of the stiffness and the mass matrices of a beam, an Euler-Bernoulli beam, and based on that, you can extend this to other elements, but you get the basic understanding of how to develop stiffness and mass matrices. There's also another matrix that is important in dynamics, which is the damping matrix, and the derivation is kind of similar, so but will not cover that. So we are done with mass and stiffness matrices, and in the next class we are going to talk about how we assemble the elements together, and then how we impose boundary conditions. For example, if you have no rotation in one end, or if you have two elements and you have to match the displacements and the rotations, then we'll see how to do that in order to find the final equations. Let's stop here.